Happy Sunday. I want to express my appreciation to the choral group for presenting the anthem to us. They practice very hard, you know, and I want to appreciate the respective spouses for bearing with them. I was noticing that people are hanging around right after worship service. I was thinking, why are they hanging around for so long? The answer is because the spouse practicing the choral anthem. And we have taped it, and we want to play on the second service as well, so that our brothers and sisters, the second service, can also come and appreciate this. And again, I want to encourage you to think deeply into what is it that God will want you to do through this worship service that we have. And choral music is something that is close to my heart, actually. I mean, I grew up in church, and I was in choirs and musical plays. I was in many musical plays. But later, the Lord would lead my ministry into different direction. And so every time, you know, you have a urge to raise your hand and say, I want to join the choir, but I can't, you know, because you have to practice a lot and do a lot of this. So I do appreciate it. And I know that the Lord will reward every one of us that labor for Him. Now, today we enter into one of the most dramatic portion of Exodus. And although it's Exodus 7, I'm going to be covering many chapters because we're going to deal with the plagues all at one shot, and not one plague at a time, because that will take a long time, because the lesson point of each of the plague is actually quite similar, except the last one. So before that, let's review a little bit what was taught in the last lesson. Last lesson, we were at Exodus 6 and Isaiah 40 as the other key verse. Remember that the lesson point last week was really about the Lord and the gap between God and humanity. And last week's lesson was a little bit unusual because after the lesson, both in the morning and the afternoon service, people came to approach me, either in writing or came personally to discuss the details about the sermon. And that made me very happy. You know, in Chinese churches, they have a tradition of after worship service, you shake the hand of the people and everybody sort of tell you a good message, pastor, or 感谢主, or whatever, you know, 刚才讲得很好, or something like that. Now, you ask, where is it good? They will get stuck, you know, because they don't know what to say, because it's like a tradition. They always tell you it's a good sermon. But I'm happy that in this congregation, there are people who will write to me and challenge the points, and there are people who do research as to some of the things that I said and point out the inaccuracy or further questions relating to it. And that's really great. So please do a lot of that kind of a thing. But of course, the sermon proper is a little bit complicated and a pretty profound kind of a lesson. It started with the understanding that Moses was very disappointed at the first defeat, right? He went to see Pharaoh after he had a high of receiving special gifts from God in signs and wonders, and went to tell the people of Israel that God had sent him. But, you know, Pharaoh not only did not release the people, but go and gave him worse news by asking them to make bricks without straw. And really, then his responses to God was quite terrible, and he sort of told God that, why do you even bother to send me? And so then chapter 6 is a chapter where God paused almost for a moment to explain himself, so to speak. And the key sentence that was seen throughout the chapter 6 was this phrase, I am the Lord. And I explained to you that in the English language, we are very limited. And the word Lord, all capitalized, actually has a lot more meaning than just a master and a servant kind of a concept. And God went on to say that for the longest time, for Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God was known as God Almighty, or in Hebrew, El Shaddai, God who is almighty. And not that the word Lord did not appear earlier, but the emphasis was God Almighty in the previous generation. But God declared that from Moses henceforth, he is going to be known as the Lord, or in Hebrew, Yahweh, in transliteration, Jehovah. And this is a kind of a major shift in direction. From the Almighty God, God is now declaring that he will be personal to the people Israel. And that is seen in the next phrases that God used often. There are 7 times the word I will appeared in chapter 6. And God said, I will deliver you. I will make you my people. I will give you the land. And so all 7 times a declaration that God not only is almighty, now he will fulfill all that he has said to Moses and his people. However, the Bible also says that Moses and his people just could not understand. In chapter 6, verse 9, I believe. And you know, because of their suffering and their many years of struggling among them. And so I took the opportunity to tell you that actually the chapter is not just about historical misunderstanding between the position of God and the position of mankind. More than anything else, it really demonstrates that there is a huge gap between humanity and God. And I talk about how it is in at least three areas. Anthropomorphic area, where we think that God is like us, like human being. Dimensional area, where we think that God is trapped in time-space like us. Certain dimension, large, small, heavy, small, and light. And at transactional, which is the idea that I do to God whatever God will do to me, the way we deal with each other in life. You know, after the sermon, I went to dig further and think a little bit further about this. And I don't know whether you remember this or not. Long time ago, I showed you a picture before of an arm wrestling picture. Jesus Christ arm wrestling with the devil. And I came across that picture again. So this is a picture where Jesus Christ on one side. Of course, we don't know what Jesus looked like, but everybody think that he looked like a white guy and very clean and very handsome and long hair and beard and all that, right? So the picture show him arm wrestling with the devil, who is, of course, you know, red color and fire everywhere type of thing. And the interesting thing about this picture is that nobody seems to be winning the arm wrestling, you know. It was like in the middle of nowhere. Either they are going to start arm wrestling, or in the middle of arm wrestling, both are as strong as each other, so it's kind of stuck down there, right? I showed you that before in one of the sermons. But this time around, I found more of that picture, and I went to dig a little bit further. I was quite surprised to find that actually this is an entire category of pop art. The idea that Jesus will arm wrestle with the devil is seen in posters and big, very big kind of a frame-up picture that people can buy and hang it in your house. On coins, people make coins of this, and the biggest one of them all is on tattoos. There are people who tattoo the thing on their stomach and the whole of their back. One giant picture of Jesus Christ arm wrestling with the devil. This is exactly what this is talking about. To think that God is like us, anthropomorphic in nature, and dimensional, and so, you know, the devil is like an evil God and Jesus Christ is the good God. It's a classic fight between the good and evil, the yin and the yang, kind of a Chinese kind of concept. But of course, this is theologically wrong, right? Because I think in that sermon, what I mentioned is that the transcendence of God, that God is the holy other, and the devil and all the works of the devil are just temporal in nature, that God has allowed the devil to do whatever it and all its followers are doing temporarily. It's not like he is another very powerful God. You know, he is actually already defeated. So I tell you, when you get a tattoo, you have to be very careful. You are tattooing the wrong thing on your whole back, no? You know, theologically unsound. And I don't know how you're going to get rid of it finally or correct it. And it's really quite big. I'm so surprised that so many people have done that. So the idea is that God is the holy other and he is transcendent to us. And so in Exodus 6, you find that the phrase "I am the Lord" is repeated many times, as if God has problem trying to explain himself to a group of people who never could understand. Last week, somebody sent me a phrase that I thought was very interesting. He said, the difference between us and God is as if we are trying to explain the internet to an ant. I thought that's quite funny, to explain the internet to an ant. Yeah, it's quite similar to that. However, God is not just a holy other. God is also personal to us. So we use the word eminent. So he is eminent. He is with us. And this is very unusual and understanding, but it comes from the Reformed understanding that God is willing to reveal himself to us. So yes, he is the holy other God. But as you see in Exodus 6, he was willing to come and say, I will do this, I will do that. General revelation of God in nature and special revelation of God in the Bible. And so the only thing left to do really is coram Deo, the Latin phrase, living in the presence of God. And I thought that the lesson continued to circle round and round, at least in my own mind, as I think further. If you think about it, the way we live life, this morning when you come over here and you attend this worship service, I say easily 90% of what you are thinking about
belong to the first three categories: anthropomorphic, dimensional, transactional. Very few of us have the ability to live before the presence of God. We typically live in our own presence. We think about issues relating to comfort in my own needs. I'm coming to church to fulfill my needs. Very few of us have the sensitivity to understand or the spiritual maturity to understand that you are here before God. And not only today or at this moment, every single day of your life. And so prayerfully, that's the way we should live our life. And as we move on in our lives, when you become more spiritually mature, Coram Deo will become more and more the way you should live life, because that's the only possible right response towards God Almighty, who is both transcendence and eminent. And now we go on to the one of the most dramatic portion of Exodus. There are many interesting dramatic portions, but the plagues mentioned in Exodus is of course the key one. And that spans from chapter 7 all the way to chapter 10. So let's come before God in a word of prayer as we enter into this new lesson point. Let us pray. We commit the time into your almighty hands, O God, and ask that you help us to be humble and teachable in our spirit. Whatever it is that we have encountered in the past week, help us to cast it all to you, because we know you care for us, so that we can be attentive to your word and that we will listen to you and open up our heart towards you. May the words of your unworthy servant and the meditation in all our heart and mind be deemed acceptable in your sight. For you are our God and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so after Exodus 6, God declared himself to Moses, "Now it's time for action." And so the Lord said to Moses, "See, I have made you like God to Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron shall be your prophet. You shall speak all that I command you, and your brother Aaron shall tell Pharaoh to let the people of Israel go out of this land." And verse 3 began the difficult portion of Exodus and the plagues. "But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, Pharaoh will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt and bring my host, my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt, and by great acts of judgment, the Egyptian shall know." Here comes the phrase again: "I am the Lord. When I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring out the prophets of bring out the people of Israel from among them." And from then onwards, the miraculous signs started. It started a bit mild, right, with the demonstration of the serpent, or the staff turning into serpent. And the Bible tells us that Pharaoh and his wise men or sorcerer were able to do the same, except that the serpent of Aaron went to swallow up the other two serpents. But the most spectacular things happen in the following things, the plagues that happen. I'm going to be focusing on the first 9 plagues rather than the last, and keep the last one for next week, because the last plague is not just a combination of the 10 plagues, but it carries a lot of significant lesson relating to the salvation plan of God. Now, all the plagues, all 9 of them, actually followed certain kind of patterns. First of all, the plagues were increasing in its severity. Started with the water of Nile turned to blood, and then it gets more and more severe and become from outside to become inside and very personal. And the 10th plague was the most severe of them all, which was the death of all the firstborn of the Egyptian. The other pattern that happened was that every time the plague happened, there were counter miracles from Pharaoh's priests and sorcerers. But this only happened until the second plague. By the third plague, the sorcerers were not able to replicate. Now, a lot of people wonder what sort of secret arts, that the word used in the Bible is secret art, that the sorcerers have. There are good chance that the sorcerers were using illusion of some sort, a sleight of hand of some sort. But we generally accept that it is possible that people who serve Satan exhibit certain kind of signs and wonders of their caliber or of their situation. And for those of us who live among multi-religious situation and local faith and all that, you can be quite familiar with it. I'm very familiar with it because, as I mentioned to you before, I grew up amidst many, many different temples and local faiths. So I'm very familiar with many of the things that these people practice. I would say that vast majority of them are not real. You know, a lot of psychological or psychosomatic, whatever it is. But there remain a certain percentage that is quite difficult to explain. So we do accept that it is possible that there are people out there who are so in line with the work of Satan that they could exercise certain powers. But as you see in the plague, it sort of got stuck somewhere down the line. In this particular case, by the third plague, it was not able to reproduce it. And with all that, the reactions of the people were all quite similar. They all were in misery. Then they go complain to Pharaoh, including the sorcerer, by the way. And then, you know, and then Pharaoh had to do something about it. And the pattern that is seen in all plague is the hardening of Pharaoh's heart after each plague. And later on, the deception that Pharaoh would give in order to get rid of the plague. Then after that, he hardened his heart again. So this thing keep repeating itself for all the nine plagues until the very last one, when Pharaoh finally let the people go. Let's go through the plagues. Plague 1, water turned into blood. Chapter 7, 14 to 24. Now, the word blood here, many people think that may not be literal blood. For example, the Bible says that the moon will be turned to blood, meaning it will be turned to red color. So some people think that the word blood actually just meant very red sediment kind of a situation. But the Bible, as you have read in your responsive reading, the whole river now plus bottles and stuff that are in the household, not just the river itself. So that's the first one. The second one, frogs, was the second plague where frogs swam the whole place, and that extends to chapter 8, verse 15. And frogs just come out all over the place and swam the whole of Egypt. And after the frog comes the third plague, which is the plague of gnats. Now, this is a little bit unusual, chapter 8, verse 16 to 19. Chapter 8 contains several of the plagues, and some of description are quite short. The gnats description is actually very short, only about 4 or 5 verses only. The original language of the gnats is very difficult to define. Is it a flying insect or not? Some people believe that actually the original language meant lice or bed bugs kind of a thing. Have you seen bed bugs before? Anyway, have you seen bed bugs before? Raise your hand. Really? Most Singaporeans have never seen bed bugs. You want to see bed bugs? Join me as we clean up the houses of the elderly poor in Singapore. Some of you have never seen bed bugs before. Very resilient, okay? Bed bugs, I think bed bugs will survive a nuclear war. They're very strong. You can spray a whole can of insecticide on it, you can still survive, like yawn yawn, no problem. to kill bed bugs, you need to bring in fumigators. Very serious kind of a thing. So the gnats could be bed bug lice kind of a thing, and they sort of flood the whole of Egypt. And then the reason why it's probably crawling on the floor instead of flying is because of the next plague. The next plague is the plague of flies, which swarms the whole thing flying. So therefore, chances is one plague is on the floor and one is flying. Now, by the time that these plagues came, Pharaoh was beginning to shake a little bit. So if you read chapter 8, verse 28, for example, Pharaoh began to tell Moses, go sacrifice to your God within the land, but then don't go too far away. So he start to negotiate with them. And verse 28, Pharaoh said, I will let you go to sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness, only you must not go very far away. That's when the plague of the flies came, which is by the time the fourth plague. And Pharaoh added one word, plea for me or pray for me. So that's quite interesting, because here you have an enemy of God telling you to pray for him. It also teaches the side lesson that people say anything, okay, just to get out of the predicament. And as pastor, I tell you, that's the case. Oftentimes when you're desperate, and you call your pastor and ask your pastor to help you, you say all kinds of spiritual things, right? Why? Next time I'm going to pray or whatever. I want to do good for God. And of course, God is not stupid. But Pharaoh was just using this as a trick. So after the flies really disappear, again, he hardened his heart. The fifth plague then came, which is the death of the livestock of Egypt. So all kinds of livestock of Egypt died, but the livestock of the Israelites did not die. So you can see that in chapter 9, only 7 verses. And after that, again, the same pattern repeat itself. And after the fifth plague came the sixth plague, which are boils that cannot be healed. Chapter 9, verse 8 to 12. And all of the Egyptians had that. And even the magicians were people who were covering with boys. So in this particular illustration, actually they illustrated magician people who have the boys. And then came the seventh plague, which is a very severe plague. So it gets more and more severe. And now it's like mass scale plague in seven, where hailstone will drop down from the sky and fire as well. So fire and hailstone. So oftentimes we use the word fire and brimstone preacher. Like our senior pastor is considered a fire and brimstone preacher, very fierce, you know, preach fire and brimstone because of biblical references of Sodom and Gomorrah, fire from heaven, and also this one, hailstone that came and fire also came. So this is seen in chapter 9, verse 13 to 35. And in this particular chapter, Pharaoh went one step further because it looks very scary. All of Egypt was affected. And in verse 27, chapter 9, Pharaoh sent and called Moses and Aaron and said to them, "This time I have sinned. The Lord is in the right, and I, my people, are in the wrong. Plead with the Lord, for there has been enough of God's thunder and hail, and I will let you go. And you shall stay no longer." So again, this time around, Pharaoh went one step further. Earlier he said, "Just pray for me." Now he said, okay, I surrender. I'm in the wrong, and your Lord is right. So please pray for me. But of course, again, it was just a ploy to get rid of the hailstorm. And when that happened, Bible again says that Pharaoh's heart was hardened. And after this, the next plague was also a very severe plague, the plague of the locusts. The locusts flew in and had a big plague. Locusts are grasshoppers, except there is a whole mass of grasshoppers. And why is the locust plague worse than the hail? The hail actually destroyed, the Bible tells us, some of the crops. But the locusts will destroy all the crops of the Egyptian. Now, of all the plagues in the Bible, biblical plagues, only a few can be imagined today, because the turning of water into blood in a mass scale, or that you can't quite imagine. Hailstone we can imagine because there are hailstone coming. Darkness, not so much, but the locust is one biblical plague that can be experienced. It can be experienced because the locust infestation and all that is still prevalent today. I'm going to show you a short video so you get an understanding of what this must be like when the plague of locusts came. This is a video taken in Madagascar in 2013, where there was suddenly a locust plague that happened in that land. So take a look at it and you will see. I try to imagine you as an Egyptian and seeing this right before your very eyes.
For three quarters of an hour, a giant swarm of locusts about 15 kilometres long crosses Madagascar's National Route 7. This road is normally popular with tourists who come for the breathtaking views. But today they're observing a natural disaster, a plague of locusts which has already destroyed half of the island's crops.
They can create a lot of damage. They eat the pastures and then also the rice and the corn, which is about to be harvested.
According to experts, there are currently 100 swarms across Madagascar, made up of about 500 billion locusts. And they get through around 100,000 tons of vegetation every single day.
There's already not much rice. Not many people have more than 10 hectares of crops. So after the locusts, there's nothing left for our women and children to eat. The cattle have nothing left to eat either. So we're left with nothing once the locusts have been here.
Okay, so actually this documentary show is quite long. It talks up and then it traces the cause of the locusts and what have you. But in the beginning, I don't know whether you see it. Now, the locusts are so many that they actually cover the sky and the sky looks black in color. And I don't know whether you heard it or not. The locust length was 16 kilometers long. 16 kilometers long of locust swarm flying through Madagascar, consuming 100,000 tons of crops a day. So it's land on the thing and anything that's green in color will all be eaten away. And so that was the case for the Egyptians as well. The plague of the locusts came and swam the whole place and eat up everything, everything that is left over. And so while the plague of the hail was very strong, the plague of the locusts cover up. And the Bible described it in this way, Exodus 10,
chapter 10, verse 15, they covered the face of the whole land so that the land was darkened, and they ate all the plants in the land and all the fruit of the trees that the hail had left. So the hailstorm destroyed a lot, but the locusts came and swiped the rest of the things and killed everything else. And not a green thing remained, neither tree nor plant of the field to all the land of Egypt. So that's how frightening this plague was. And then, but still, you know, Pharaoh did not let the people go. And then come the ninth plague, which is darkness. I know you can't quite see the illustration, but it's okay, it's darkness. So it says darkness covered the whole land for 3 days. And so all the plagues was listed here until the last one, which I will touch next week. And all these are very spectacular and big scale events. So today when we read the Bible, many people, when they study the plagues and they try to find some explanation of different sorts, including Christian scholars, and there were many explanations out there. First of all, they are historical things. So therefore, you can check history. Other than the Bible, there are recordings all over the place about this. Many people believe that these are myths, figments of imagination, written by Moses. So if you are atheist historian or people who don't believe in God, you say, okay, this one all fake. Not a single one is real. There are a second group of people who say that they were real phenomena, but simple natural phenomena. Now, I've told you that there are movies that are interesting to watch, and it sort of tell you about all these things, right? So, Ten Commandments was one of them. The other one is Exodus of Gods and Men, starring Christian Bale. Now, that one take on second position, because in this particular thing, the turning of the river from water to blood started because, so in the movie, they show fishermen, they were fishing, and then there were crocodiles that came. So something like they throw the fish and the crocodile at the fish, and another crocodile went to attack the first crocodile and beat him. And when the crocodile was beaten, what came out? Blood, yeah. So when the blood came out, more crocodiles came in and they beat each other, and then the blood keep growing. And so, yeah, so the whole river become blood-like because the crocodile then died and more crocodile came, and then it's a multiplication effect. Whole river become bloody. And then because the river become bloody, the frogs got upset, got nowhere to go. So they go and jump up on the land and then keep jumping all over the places. And so in that particular movie starring Christian Bale, they take the second position that yes, it happened, but they are actually very natural phenomena. The frogs came out, then the frogs die, and because the frogs die, then what is the next one that came out? Then the mosquito came because they feed on the, you know. So one thing lead to another because of that. You will be quite surprised that even Christian commentators or people who write commentary would sometimes take that position, because it seems so out of the world to think that suddenly all these locusts would appear. The third position is that some people will argue that, okay, they are real, moderately miraculous lah. So yes, it happened at that time, but God caused the first crocodile to bite ma. So, you know, so somewhere in between. And the final position is our position, which is they were miraculous sign that involve natural elements. The sky, the everything, absolutely. And they are all miraculous signs that God has actually allowed. So therefore, the position of the Reformed Evangelical, which is actually quite mainstream position, is we accept a literal reading of the plagues. We believe that when the Bible says that the locusts came, it was because God caused the locusts to come. Yes, it could be that God moved the locusts from somewhere else to where it is, but still it would not have happened if God did not meant it to teach Pharaoh a lesson. So that's what the plague is all about. The more difficult question relating to the plague is relating to the heart of Pharaoh. And herein lies one of the most difficult portions of the study of Exodus. Because the Bible tells us in many different ways that the heart of Pharaoh was hardened. And you go and think about it, the plague, okay, don't talk about others, look at the locusts, right? Can you imagine if Lee Hsien Loong is being punished? Am I being recorded? I am. And God said, I'm going to send locusts to all of Singapore, and the locusts go to your house everywhere, okay? You get so upset, you go and complain to your
MP la, you know, you make a lot of noise. You go to the street and protest, but in Singapore, we have no street protest. We will whine and we will write to forum page. Wow, very serious, write to forum page, you know. And you will force the government to do something, right? Just one. But here you have so many plagues, you know, and Pharaoh continued to be hardened. And we see in plague one with the blood, 722, but the magicians of Egypt did the same. Pharaoh's heart remained hardened. Plague number two, the frogs. When Pharaoh saw that there was a repipe, the frogs all got chased away by Moses, he hardened his heart. So you see the description. One is he remained hardened, meaning in the first place already hardened. Second plague is he hardened his heart. Plague number three, the gnats or the lice. But then the magician said to Pharaoh, hey, this is the finger of God because they cannot produce it anymore. But Pharaoh's heart was hardened and he would not listen to them as the Lord has said. Because the Lord said, remember beginning of Exodus 7 as we read it, that Pharaoh will harden his heart. So as the Lord has said, predicted it will happen. But as he go on, it gets more complicated. Plague 4, flies. But Pharaoh hardened his heart this time, did not let the people go. Plague 5, livestock. And Pharaoh sent, and behold, not one of the livestock of Israel was dead. But the heart of Pharaoh was hardened. He did not let the people go. Plague 6, boys. But the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh. So you see many different descriptions. As the Lord has said, he was already hardened. He then hardened his heart. But in plague number 6, the Bible says the Lord was the one who hardened the heart of Pharaoh. And verse 7, when Pharaoh saw that the rain and the hail and the thunder had ceased, he sinned yet again and hardened his heart. So plague number 7, the Bible described it as Pharaoh's own sin. He sinned yet again and he's hardened the heart, he and his servant. So the heart of Pharaoh was hardened and he did not let the people go. Plague number 8, the locusts. Again, the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, but he did not let the people go. And plague number 9, the darkness. The Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he will not let the people go. So out of 9 times description, the Lord hardens Pharaoh's heart appear how many times? 3 times. So it's about a third of the description was the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did not let the people go. The rest is like he sinned, his heart was hardened and all that. So it is a little bit kind of confusing. So what exactly is it? Did the Lord harden his heart? Did he sin himself? Was his heart already hardened? Was he born with a hardened heart? Herein lies one of the most difficult aspects of the Reformed evangelical position of God's sovereign will. And this particular incident was handled by the Apostle Paul, actually in Romans chapter 9. So in Scripture, one of the principles of studying Scripture is that you need to look at the whole of Scripture, as senior pastor always say, the general principle of the whole Bible. And if the New Testament has an explanation or a kind of enlightenment, then actually it quite settled the case, you know. So in Romans chapter 9, Paul was arguing that God is sovereign in life. The Reformed Evangelical Church is very famous or notorious, if you want to use that word, for the insistence of election and the sovereignty of God. I once asked Dr. Seven Tong, how come you are Reformed? Dr. Tong said, because I believe in the sovereignty of God. That's why I'm Reformed. Meaning, Reformed folks believe that God, as I preached last week, transcendence, he's the holy other. He is not dependent on me. The other way around, I am depending on him. He is sovereign. He's not like one of us, or anthropomorphic like us, or transactional like us. He doesn't need us. We need him. And with all his wisdom and his perfection and his holiness and his purity and everything about him, he is sovereign and he makes all things come to pass. How do we know that? We know that because the Bible tells us so. But it's a very difficult lesson to learn. I have many good friends who are very learned. Some of them I respect a lot and they know the Bible very well too, very Christian people. They would disagree with me strongly on the idea that God is sovereign. So when you look at the example of Pharaoh then, most people's idea is that, oh, he deserved it because his heart was hardened. It is his fault. And God has nothing to do with it. But the Reformed position doesn't seem to be so. So when the Apostle Paul argued in Romans chapter 9 about the sovereign will of God, he then listed out many examples. In verse 14, what shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. So if you say that Pharaoh's heart was hardened by God, surely that's not very just, not very right, right? Because not his fault, what? And Paul says, if you say that God is unjust, by no means. Verse 15, for he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then, it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. And Paul went on to write in verse 17, for the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then, he has mercy on whoever he wills, and he hardens whoever he wills. And here comes a problem. So if you say that God hardens Pharaoh's heart because God hardens whoever he will, then it is not fair. I remember having one of these discussions with this learned senior person. We were in Malabo, right? We were doing all this tsunami work. And it was right about 6 months after the tsunami disaster. And we were in Hotel Malabo, the only hotel left there. And the hotel was still sort of recovering from the tsunami. You could see the seaweed, no? two-story high. That shows you how high the water covered. Two-story, a whole line of seaweed around the hotel. They are so lazy that they haven't even cleaned that up. But I guess it became a tourist attraction. So we were discussing theology because no TV, nothing to do. So we talked theology. And so I said, you from what church? I said, we Reform Evangelical. I said, what about you? He said, oh, we're brethren. And what have you? I don't know why, but we drifted to the idea of election. And this guy that I respect so much was so adamant. He said, I just cannot understand why you guys believe that God would elect some to be saved and then elect others not to be saved. How come you can believe that God can harden the heart of Pharaoh? Because it's a Pharaoh's fault, it's not God's fault. And so we had very lively discussion on this. In the end, we have to leave each other alone because we were about to kill each other. So it's a very tough particular thing. But the Bible says, God said he will have mercy towards those whomever he wills, and he will harden the heart of whoever he will. So on the surface then, and linking to last week's lesson, because we are anthropomorphic in the way we think, dimensional and transactional. When we read things like that, the picture we have in our mind is that this God is a God who is very flippant, you know, up to him. Whether he wake up in the morning on the wrong side of the bed, then he's not very happy, he will zap you or whatever, kill you or make life very difficult for you. Because that's the way we are, right? Come on. One of the big surprises that all of you who just got married would be that your wife, usually it's the wife, it's not what you thought she would be like early in the morning. Am I right? Or the husband? Am I right? Because without makeup, you can be another person altogether, kind of thing. And then the hair over the place, all kind of thing. I don't believe that you all wake up looking very nice. I know my wife does, but she cheat a bit. She wake up much earlier, makeup first, and then after that, when I wake up, wow, so nice, you know. And we think that God is like us, because you wake up on the wrong side of the bed, you're very unhappy, right? It may surprise you, your pastor is not a morning person. Ask my wife. I'm not a morning person, okay? So, you know, wake up in the morning, hi, sunshine, no such thing for me, man. Like, very grouchy, very... Take me a while, I'm going to gear myself up and remember Coram Deo, I have to remind myself, you know, living before the presence of God. And so, very mood dependent, you know what I mean, the way we live our life. And so because we are anthropomorphic, we think God is like that as well. You got to. That's why I say that 90% of the time we got wrong, because we gauge God the way we gauge. In our understanding of God's sovereign choice, you must know these few things. Number one, we believe God is fully sovereign in his will. So basing on last week's lesson, because he's transcendent, he's the holy other. You are talking about a being who is absolutely pure, absolutely holy, absolutely wise in every sense of the word. And so my personal engineering kind of summary is just one very simple statement. God cannot possibly make a mistake. I think just on this statement alone, you spend your entire life thinking and meditating on it. Because it's not our experience in life. We make mistakes. We make a lot of mistakes, right? I mean, sadly, you look at the SAF thing that's happening now. Poor boy and what have you. So my daughter and I were discussing, how can this happen? She keep asking me, how can it be that someone cannot kept by the howitzer and what have you? I said that, you know, army is, yeah, better don't say so much. All the mothers get very worried. it is a risky kind of a business and it's very tough. And all kinds of mistakes happen all over the place, right? Big ones, small ones, all over the place. And they all use study like crazy for your A-level. People lose your exam paper, okay? The guy bring it home, no? Mr. Brown said, huh, can bring home one man? In Singapore, all our teachers cannot trap in a room to mark your paper, cannot go home. Well, in Cambridge, you can bring home, eh? And then drink tea and mark, and then leave it in the train and all the years and years of hard work all gone. Because some clown leave it in the train and forgot. And then go back, boleh, disappear. Why it disappear? I tell you where it goes to. It come back to Singapore. Some guy is selling it somewhere in the shopping mall, the latest 10-year series. So mistakes. So we think that people have made mistakes. Can you wrap your mind around a God that cannot possibly make a mistake? I can't, you know. If you can, congratulations. I think you're more spiritual than I am. It's just really very, very tough thing for us to grab. A God who cannot possibly make a mistake. Plus the attributes of God being good, being just, being righteous, being faithful, immutable, it doesn't change, being eternal. Now, Dr. Tong has been preaching through the series of Faith in True Way Presbyterian Church in the evening. So last week he was touching on this. He was talking about how faith is trusting God, the direction of your heart. Quite a complicated many weeks of preaching. And last week he said that, you know, one of the reasons why you can trust God is because of three things, the three attributes of God. See the advantage of being his translator, you remember things like that. The problem is that I remember it late into at night. So I tell you, Sunday night after I translate for him, I go back, very hard to sleep because you keep circling in your mind. You want to stop, but you can't. You keep moving around. Three things he said. Number one, God is faithful. 信实 in Chinese, faithful. So that's the first attribute you must know. Faithful means that everything he said he will do. No such thing as he says something and he will not happen. So number one, God is faithful. Number two, and who was there last week? Chrissy was there. But I don't want to put you on the spot. Number two, God is immutable. He doesn't change. In him, there's no shadow of change. So God is faithful, who doesn't change. So you can trust him. And number three, he's eternal. So the three attributes. He only mentioned three. Actually, there are more. So you go and frame your mind around a God who is faithful, who doesn't change, and who will last forever and ever and ever. Never grow old one. Sounds like a man you should marry, right? You know, wow, very faithful. You know, from day one, he whispered a sweet nothing to you sincerely, first day you meet. And forever is still the same thing, you know. He won't do things which my late father always do. I ask my late father, you got show my mother any expression or not? Got buy flowers or not? And all that. He always say, "Aiya, 老夫老妻不用了，我们知道的." You know, we are already very old. We don't do things like that. So not very faithful, right? So completely trustworthy. It doesn't change. No matter how old you get, God doesn't grow old, right? And he's eternal. And so all these attributes come together. And so when you think about God and how he so-called hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and as Paul says, he did that, and the Bible tells us, so that Pharaoh will do all these things and the people will know that I am the Lord. That phrase again, that declaration. It sounds very odd and very dramatic, but then it fulfills everything that God is. But because we are human beings, we find it very difficult to frame it. And so when the Bible uses words like God hardened Pharaoh's heart, absolutely it cannot be the way we understand it. When he hardened his heart just for fun, it cannot be. In his perfect wisdom, he would then, in his sovereign will, make all things come based on all this and more of his attributes. So this is something that's very difficult. At the same time, the difficulty is that the Bible declares fully that while God hardens Pharaoh's heart, perhaps a better way to understand is God allow his heart to be hardened, because the Bible declared that Pharaoh is completely responsible for his own sin. James 1:13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then the desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And when sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. So this is what we always use, the phrase paradoxical, to explain this. So if you ask, Pastor, can you explain this fully to me? I say, no, I can't. I can tell you that, number one, God is sovereign. Number two, God cannot possibly make a mistake. Number three, God is good. Number four, when you sin, it is still your fault. And all exists at the same time. This is Reformed evangelical understanding. And which, by the way, is the most biblical understanding. If not, you cannot possibly explain why the Bible would say that God would harden Pharaoh's heart. And so the sovereign will of God is above all. And these are profound and also difficult understanding, but still the Bible proclaims in essence two things. God is sovereign and God is fully in control, even as he allowed Pharaoh's heart to be hardened. At the same time, Pharaoh is fully responsible for his own sin, and both coexist at the same time. And our fallen mind cannot wrap and understand it fully. In the second service, when I was discussing this with someone, the guy suddenly blurted a sentence. Yeah, but the Bible says so, ma. So I was thinking, well, that's quite interesting. He understands that there are many things we do not quite are able to wrap our mind around it, but because the Bible says so, it's a revelation from God. For example, your children's Sunday school song, right, which I love so much. Jesus loves me, this I know. What's the next verse? For the Bible tells me so. You know, we sing this like a kid. Yeah, Jesus loves me. Yeah, Jesus loves me. Very cute, right? Very profound, you know. This particular, of all the children's Sunday school songs, this one is most profound. Jesus loves me, this I know. For the Bible tells me so. Because you can go and crack your brain and think, lah. You think you're very lovely, is it? You know. Go and ask my wife, Lord, am I lovely? And am I a nice guy? Get her drunk, she will tell all kind of nonsense about me, you know. We're not lovely people. We're horrible, you know. Come on. If you know what's in my mind, I tell you, you will go and petition Patong to have me fired as your pastor. Because we are not, we're just not. Why? Don't know why. Why would God love you? I mean, what? You very precious. You got gold. What do you have? Why? Don't know. Because the Bible tells you so. So it's the same with the sovereign choice of God. Because the Bible tells us so. But still, there are other very important lessons from the plague, other than the sovereignty of God. The plagues demonstrated the full existence of God against all the false idols of Egypt. Actually, the plagues itself is targeted at Egyptian God, the God of the fly, the God of the frog, all kinds of different gods, the God of the river Nile. And the darkness is the sun god, Ra. So there is a concurrent demonstration that God is above all the other gods as well. It also demonstrates that God's power is absolutely real. So we believe the plague to be real. They're not imagination. They actually happen in history. And most importantly, relevant to us, the plague demonstrated that God will punish and bring justice to bear on evil doers. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the plague demonstrated that sin will not go unanswered. And this is a very important lesson for us this morning as well. That the attributes of God certainly include God as a just God. That in the justice of God, no evil or sin will go unanswered or unpunished. And in the second focal verse that our sister Irene read to us, it shows that for many of us, including the people in the church, we are very mistaken about the grace of God. And so Peter says this, 2 Peter 3:3, knowing this first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. This is one reason why we know we are in the last days. And many people talk about how, oh, you know, this time, the earthquake, this and that, shows us that we are in the last days. I think not, no. I think the most important part is that the scoffers appearing among us indicate that we are indeed moving towards the last days. They will say, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation. But by the same word, the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. Make no mistakes, the Bible predicts that we are moving into the last days and destruction will come. Because like the plagues given to the Egyptian, God will punish evildoers and have all sins answered. And we mean all sins, not small, big, big, giant sin and small, small sin, no count. In the eyes of God, anything that keeps us away from him is sin. And all sins will be answered, including that of the people of God. And so therefore, it is right when we use the word, we fear the Lord. Part of that healthy fear must be in the fear of the punishment that will come because of our disloyalty, our laziness, our own sins that we commit. However, let me also be very clear about this, that Christians in the sight or in the anticipation of the last day should not be fearful. Because the general principle is that all sins must be answered, including the smallest one in your life. Jesus said, every single idle word you utter, you have to be held accountable for. So that's the first principle. At the same time, the second principle is that when we face God in what is called the Great White Throne, Revelation chapter 20, our sins have been answered already by our Lord Jesus Christ. And so when we are at the Great White Throne, we will be judged not for our sins, but for rewards. That's very clear in the Bible. At the same time, remember that the punishment for God is very, very real. As real as the plagues were for the people of Egypt, the people who do not know God will have to face the punishment that is very, very real from God. So for Christians, when we die, or when Jesus Christ comes again, whichever comes first, we do not die with fear. We die fully assured that our next consciousness is bliss, B-L-I-S-S, blessedness before God. Because our sins have been taken by our Lord Jesus Christ. So the theologian Dallas Willard has a very interesting description of death that I thought quite fascinating. He said that Christians, when we die, we probably would not know it. Because it's like a change of landscape. We sort of face into the next phase. And when we physically die, the Bible tells us we're immediately in paradise. So we won't be aware that we have died because we are moving into great blessing. Dallas Willard himself has passed away, I think, 2 years ago. You know what was his last word in his deathbed? Fascinating. He said, thank you. That was his last word, you know. Thank you. You know, maybe we have last words that are very dramatic or whatever it is. But for the people of God, he said, thank you. I thought that's fascinating. He understood. He moved into the next phase because we do not live in fear because of the work our Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. In the meantime then, Peter went on to say, since all things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in the lives of holiness and godliness, waiting and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly body will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for a new heaven and a new earth in which righteousness will dwell. And finally, he ends in 2 Peter verse 14. Therefore, my beloved, since you are waiting for this, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish, and be at peace. And so from the plagues that the Egyptians suffered, we learn a lot of theological and side lesson. But the one that is more relevant to us today is you need to know that God will not let injustice go. And God's punishment, as he did give the plagues to the Egyptians, would be very, very real. And so if there are injustice that you have suffered in your life, and like the psalmist, right, always looking at how the evil people prosper and what have you, and there are some things in your heart that you find very difficult to let go because some people have done you great harm. Or sometimes you look at the world and you don't quite get it. How come God will allow all these things to happen? That's because you are dimensional. You think in a time-space kind of a trap. You must know that Scripture affirms that as much as the Egyptians suffer the plague, evildoer will absolutely, without a doubt, suffer the punishment from God because God is just. In the meantime, the people of God need not fear because we are as much a sinner as the non-believers, but because of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are covered by his blood. And so we need not fear death, nor should we fear the judgment of God because we will face him for rewards. And where will the rewards come from? Or from what basis? From the basis of what's happening in the meantime. And so may I encourage you to understand and to think deeply into what Peter says. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for justice to come, finally, in the meantime, be diligent. Work hard for the Lord. Don't be idle and just drift your life so that when he comes, you will be found without spot or blemish, and in the life you live right now, be at peace. Because he is sovereign and he will ensure that justice will finally be done. Let us pray. We thank you, God, for the lesson that we have learned today. Help us to remember that other than the theological lessons, there are important reminder to us all that you are a real God. And you will, for the moment in time, may allow evil to continue in the world because your timing is perfect and it is not up yet. But in due time, the way you have given the plagues to the Egyptians to punish them for their unrighteousness and sins, you will do the same for all who will sin against you. But yet, we know Jesus loved me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. For us, for whatever the reason, you have chosen us to be your people. And so we need not fear the punishment that is to come for the sinners because Jesus Christ has already taken that load from us. And so in the meantime then, we need to live a life where we are diligent for you, serving you, loving you, by serving and loving people made in your image and likeness, so that when you should see us again, we will be able to meet you without blemish, without regret. We will be able to be at peace in this lifetime. Oh, there are so many lessons for us all. We do pray that you keep us humble and teachable so that after the voice of the preacher should end, we will continue to hear the Holy Spirit speaking in our hearts and then because of that, continue to live a life that is pleasing unto you. For there is no other way to live life. This is not only life, but life abundant. Listen to our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.